Thank you, Hope. I'm actually your city relic, but that's okay. So, I am so impressed. Everybody apparently is wash and wear around here, and we are all just in the spirit. That's good news. Nice to see you all. You can read that. Bottom one. Harry Culver was born in 1880 in the dark in Nebraska. I think we have somebody who came from Nebraska here. Does anybody come from Nebraska? Put your hand up. Okay.
Yeah, from there.
Okay, good. We've got that. All right, that's good. Harry Culver's parents, Ada and Jacob Culver, had five children. Needless to say, at the time, they didn't value the girls very much, so their pictures are not on anything. However, we do have pictures of all the four boys and the father. The father was really interested in the military, very dedicated, and so the sons picked that up very much, especially Harry. I think that you can read a lot about things, but when you have examples of documents and written pieces that were done by those folks or their families, it really brings it home a little bit more to you. And one of the things that we have had the tremendous advantage of in Culver City is that we have known Pat Culver Battle, Harry Culver's daughter, who was very helpful in giving us a lot of information and allowing us to use a lot of their photographs and their documents to round out the story. This is one of my favorites. Culver, who was born on January 22nd, coming up in Milford, had an autograph book when he was 8 years old. And in this autograph book, there was an entry in 1888 from his aunt. And if you can read it, can you read it from there? Okay, can we? I don't know, is it possible? No, I mean, can you?
Can I write it larger? Make it bigger?
No, just write, sharpen it, or does it not? Maybe it's just too big. Okay, I can read that, I'm okay. Dear Harry, always aim to be truthful, generous, and loving while a little boy, and then you will grow to be a good and noble man. As the twigs bend, the tree is inclined. Your loving aunt, Charilla. That was in 1888, as we said, and I think that that kind of sets the tone for the way the family read life. Harry Culver, like I said, was very influenced by his father and the fact that they were interested in the military, and he was an underage trumpeter. We don't spread that around a lot, but he was an underage trumpeter during the Spanish-American War. And that's a picture of Harry, front and center. Move forward, way ahead. By 1910, Harry Culver had arrived in this area, and this is a picture of Harry in 1913. This was the year that he made his announcement. Jeff Cooper on his knees. What do you want, Jeff? Thank you. Okay, anyway, Harry Culver arrived in the area in 1910, and he studied for a long time looking around the area for about a year before he actually made any decisions. And he went to work for a fellow by the name of I.N. Van Nuys, obviously the Valley. According to family lore, apparently Van Nuys thought he was so valuable that they actually offered him a management job. His feeling was, well, if I'm that good, maybe I should go out on my own. So what he did is he spent a long time looking around, about a year, and he studied the area, and he came up with this place where we are today. He felt like this was an area that was pretty much open space. It had been Spanish ranchos. It was ready for development. He was interested in the movie industry, and he saw someone who turned out to be Thomas Ince filming a movie on Biona Creek. Now, we are still trying to figure out which movie it is, so don't ask me, please. But we have help, and we are earnestly trying to find that out. And let me tell you what he saw. So basically, he saw Biona Creek, which looked something like this at the time. So it was lovely open space all the way to the ocean. He knew that we were carved from two Spanish ranches, Rancho Rincon de los Pueyes on the east and La Biona on the west. He knew about the Spanish land grant area. He knew about the Machados, who had claimed the first land, which became Rancho La Biona. Agustin and his brother Ignacio, along with the Talamantes family. And what he saw already here was La Biona School that had been here since 1865. So that was already in place. Our historical society marked that site, and this was the site marking with a lot of the children participating. You can see in the three pictures, the one on the left was Biona School, La Biona School, when it was first built. The one in the middle was the one that was built in the 30s that they had trouble taking down. Do you know that story?
No.
Oh. My husband worked for the engineering department. It was a sad story. Well, it seemed that a lot of the people felt that the building was just no longer viable. It really was not up to speed, and they wanted a new school. So there were some broken windows and all, but they decided that they needed a new school. So they convinced the school board, who had to go to the state architect and go through the whole process to get a new school. They had the okay to do that. So now they needed to knock down the school, the one in the middle. Okay. Pardon me?
What year was that?
It was built in the 30s, so it was, I'd have to look it up. I'm not really sure. No, the 30s is when that one was built. So anyway, it was very well built. We all knew that, but it didn't look very good. So it turns out that they tried to knock it down. They brought out the ball and chain thing.
Wrecking ball.
Wrecking ball. Wasn't a wrecking ball. Hit the building, bounced off. Nothing happened. So they came to the city, and they decided they needed to dynamite it. That's why you knock down a school, because you can't knock it down, so you have to dynamite it. So anyway, the city engineer at the time said, no, not in our city, you're not dynamiting it. That's not going to happen. So they had to take it down. But they took it down, and then they built the current school. That's my point. So it's in the third school. Also in place was St. Augustine's Church, which was there in the 1800s, and so that was the little mission church that was there currently on that site, which the Historical Society has marked. You have two other churches that were the second and third church. Perhaps even more important than all of those things was the fact that Harry Culver saw that you had the beginning of transportation. Now, this photograph has the Culver Hotel in it, so please don't think about that. What he saw at the time was not the Culver Hotel, because it wasn't built. He didn't build it until later. However, that you had the railroad station and you had the switching station. which is the Ivy substation. You had the red car running already, so you had transportation going back and forth to downtown, whatever. More important than that, he was driving along in his Pierce Arrow with his chauffeur, and his, they're driving past this, and he saw this beautiful woman, beautiful young woman. And he said, and this, we were not very well populated at the time, so everybody kind of knew everybody, so he said, who is that young woman? Thinking that, of course, the chauffeur would know. Thinks the chauffeur, I think I'm in trouble now, so I don't know who that is. And so his answer was, I think it's one of the new people. You might be able to use that sometime. Just thought I'd share it. Okay. This is what his daughter said. So anyway, it turns out that Harry Culver, because nobody knew who she was, put his people to work, and he threw a party for the new people. The doctor, his doctor's wife, went to the building where they lived on Venice Boulevard, just outside of Culver City, just across the street, and talked to the Roberts family. And so they asked if Lillian and her sister would like to come to this party that he was throwing for the new people. I don't know why they didn't get it, that they hadn't been invited. I thought, I would have thought they were part of the new people too. But anyway, they apparently were above the age limit. So it turns out that Lillian's sister did not particularly care to go. So Harry Culver's doctor and his wife agreed to pick up Lillian. And Harry Culver drove his Pierce Arrow all by himself with the doctor and his wife in the back. They drove over to the Roberts house. The doctor's wife went ahead and gathered Lillian, and they went to the party. He and Pat always used to say, and so she sat, the only seat left was next to Father, and so the die was cast. They were married in no time and had her. So anyway, that's part of the story there. This is what Harry Culver saw, really, when he was first here. And this, in 1914, 4 years after he had arrived, you will see that there wasn't a whole lot here still. This is part of Rancho La Bayona and Rincon de los Bueyes, in that area, right where they join. And so in 1914, he saw that the depot was there, which you can't really see because it's far away. You see a lot of trees where they called it Culver City Park. That is actually Media Park, the location of Media Park, which is where the Ivy substation is. Which was actually LA and is still LA, but it's on a long-term lease with the city of Culver City. And so then he decided he wanted to have a club hall. You can see the arrow for that. The club hall was undoubtedly the American Legion building in downtown. Okay, then the Culver Building and Hotel. That was what he was intending to build, the Culver Hotel, originally the Hotel Hunt. And then the grammar school. What grammar school would that have been?
Culver
Grammar, Lynn Howe now. Yeah, okay. It was rebuilt as Lynn Howe. I named Lynn Howe because that was the principal, the greatly loved principal. Okay, then the home of Harry H. Culver was on what street? He built on Delmas Terrace. Good. See? We're a very educated group. All right. This is one of the Culver ads, and I just wanted you to see this because it's so sophisticated. If you look at the top portion of the ad, you see Culver City, the home city. Well, the home in the back, what home do you think that is?
Yes.
On Delmas Terrace, which he moved up to Club Drive in Cheviot Hills so that he could build his mansion, which was designed and built by Wallace Neff. He was really impressed with Neff's work. He had built for some movie stars and some very famous people. So he engaged him. And then if you see down below, the all roads lead to Culver City, he saw all of these roads in place and the railroads, and so he knew that this was just the right place to build. Culver had a sales staff of hundreds. Look at them. A lot of people. His ads were incredible. They were very well researched and beautifully drawn and made all the sense in the world. One of the things that the Historical Society is very proud of is that we have a book of a lot of those ads, and we were able to use some of them in the centennial book. I was able to use it because Steve Rose arranged for the ads to be filmed so that they could be used. So anyway, that's one of them. Other ads. You could come for a free excursion. You could bring the family, you could be bussed in, and you could have a prettiest baby contest. Can you imagine that? Who would choose the prettiest baby? Apparently he got away with it with no problem, and he awarded the parents of the prettiest baby a lot on which to build a home. And what would happen if you did that? Then your friends would come and move here, and your family would come and move here, and you would end up with Culver City. That's what happened. On the right, one of the other ads, just amazing. He got lots of great publicity. He was heralded as pretty much of a genius. One of the others that I especially like is this one that basically says, consider the wheel of which Culver City is the hub. And that's all about the way he planned this. We were halfway between the Story Building in Los Angeles and Abbot Kinney's growing resort of Venice. And here we were, all this land in between. And of course you know that we ended up with this long, strange stretch, 7 miles of Washington Boulevard, even though we are only 5 square miles. But it was important because he understood the importance of commerce, and so he wanted us to have that line leading from one to the other for business purposes to support the community. He headed a number of real estate associations, local, and he was active in the state group. You can see him. God, I just did the wrong thing. Okay. There he is. And one of the other things that he had incredible insight into, I think, is the fact that he felt that if you establish a university in the area of your city, that this would raise the level of people, of incomes, whatever, to it, and it would be what you wanted. So he called... they called it University City up in basically what became Westchester. And Harry Culver and Fritz Burns both donated a lot of the seed money, a lot of money to Loyola for it to be built. Harry was a sports guy too. He believed in being healthy, and there he is. I'm gonna do it again. Oh, see? You give me 3 buttons, it's too many. There's Harry, there's a judge, there's the caddy, and he established at least one of the local golf courses around. This is Harry on a horse. I know you knew that, but where was the horse? That's the question. Do you know where it was? Hmm?
Holograms?
Close, but no cigar. It was up at the... What?
Bill Rogers Park.
That was a good try too, Paul. Okay, anybody else got a... It was actually in Cheviot Hills there. That was the Pacific Military Academy. He established the first Pacific Military Academy in honor of his father on Washington Boulevard at the East End, but later it was rebuilt in splendor up in Cheviot Hills. And that building you may remember as Chaminade High School later on. Pat used to love to go up there and go horseback riding. Her father taught her how to ride, and she said that her very favorite, when she was invited to a costume party, she would just go up and borrow like the polo or whatever suits from the guys up there, and she would go dressed in that. They were comfortable. That's a couple of years ago. So that was Main Street. Oh, no, I didn't. Middle Julie. Okay, right over here, that's where Pyology is today in that area. In the sidewalk in front of that, you will see a little marker that was placed there by the Historical Society to commemorate Main Street when it was filed with the county recorder in 1913 by Harry Culver. I'm sure you are all educated enough to know this now, so I'm not going to assume that you do not know it. Do you know where Culver City ends on Main Street? At the alley. You're so smart. This is great. Painless education at its best. Okay, it's a little alley that used to go to Balian's Market, was Your Way Market at one time. Okay. Anyway, so that was our fine Main Street initially. This is what the first trustees of the city looked like. And they actually met on the second floor of the building that was a theater on the side of what is the Culver Hotel today. This guy, that's Reeve Houck. Great story for you. Reeve Houck was the mayor at the end of the 20s in Culver City. He was having a very tough time getting a park in what became Culver City, so he was worried, and they couldn't come up with a name for it. It was terrible. So I was taking his daughter on a tour of the city with Gladys Chandler, who many of you probably remember, who was a school teacher and principal here in Culver City. And it turns out, Aline, the daughter, told us that the way they named Victory Park, do you know where Victory Park was? Is? Carlson Park today. Dr. Paul Carlson Park. Okay. So, this is the site of their park. It's 1927. He's finally getting a park. He's really exasperated. He's trying to get a name. Nobody gives him a name that they can really like. Okay, so his wife is standing talking to him one day, and she just was sick of hearing about him complain. So she said, oh, for heaven's sake, name it Victory Park, because it's a victory to have a park in Culver City. Now, I don't know if that's really true, but that's the family lore. And of course, you know that it was Victory Park from that time until the 1960s, when it was renamed for Dr. Paul Carlson, who lost his life as a medical missionary. So anyway, that was Reeve Houck. He is also pictured often with the Rollerdrome, which I'm sure you all remember. This is one of my favorite ads, too. And a friend of mine who is here this evening actually found it online, and it was so old we could use it. So we don't have any problems because it was early on. That was about Inceville. Inceville, as I said, was down in the area where Gladstones for Fish is today, in that area. And he wanted Inceville to move to Culver City to be part of the economic base as the first movie studio. And that's why it was Ince Triangle Studios when they came to Culver City. So that was 1915. This is Thomas Ince. Thomas Ince was a real hands-on fellow, producer, director, and what you see here is the back of Washington Row at what is now Sony, was MGM before that. So you would have had, downtown is in this area? There is Thomas Ince with one of his Native Americans, who they called Indians at the time, and that was Chief Eagle Shirt, who was the chief of all of the Indians that they used for all of these movies. And they all lived on Inceville. It was a habitat for them. So there you go. Okay, I can barely see this. We have a lot of information about incorporation of the city, and a lot of them come from the Culver family. I'm going to hit it right, yeah. Okay, this one has the voting for incorporation. The stork visits Harry Culver. That was because Pat Culver Battle was born right before we were incorporated. In fact, they used his birth so that, or her birth, so that we could be a sixth class city. We hit the right number, finally. So anyway, that worked out nicely. That's Patricia. This was their only child. This was Lillian, the actress turned Mrs. Culver. And she was asked by Mr. Culver not to be in any more movies. So she declined doing that. And the only thing he would let her do was he would let her act at like the Pasadena Playhouse. And so she did some acting there. And it wasn't until later on that she went to work at MGM eventually, and she worked there at one time. And then she also did some movies over at what is now the Culver Studios and some TV shows. But it was after Harry died. He didn't know.
Judy?
Yes.
She was also one of the founders of
the Women's Club.
Yeah,
she was. Yes, she was. Okay, so Thomas Ince's second studio in Culver City, he left the first location, and in 1918 he opened up the studio, which is now the Culver Studios. This is, the photograph is taken at the time that it was Desi Lou in the 50s, and the back lot of this studio was where the King Kong sets were burned to simulate the burning of Atlanta for Gone with the Wind. And where the prop room started, I think. And I think there's somebody here who started it. One of the people? Do I see anybody here? Yes. Yes. Okay. That's Atlanta burning, just in case you wanted to know. Okay. City Hall. Well, the city offices were located on the second floor of the building that was on the side of the Culver Hotel. But they decided to raise that, and so they decided to establish a little building that would have the city hall, the fire station, and the police station. What business would that be today?
Enjoy.
Say it louder.
Enjoy.
Enjoy eat? Yes.
Oh.
So, when you go there, you will know you are on City Hall grounds. This is part of the fun stuff that I love. So, you had the first theater here in 1918. It was on the site of Culver's Skyscraper Hotel, built in 1924, opened in 24. This particular, this is the building. This is Main Street. This is what is now Parcel B that was developed with all kinds of things. I'm sure that all of you remember the Chinese restaurant, the new Shanghai, which was new for the new Shanghai, La Bayona, the original La Bayona, the Culver House, some liquor stores that I'm sure somebody went in. at any rate, we get the funniest calls. And so one of these calls was from a fellow who was up north in Washington State. He had gone to a garage sale. Okay. He went to this garage sale and he found the scrapbook. And so he was really enamored with the movie industry himself. And so he saw this and he thought, oh my gosh, look at this. This is Thomas Ince's little theater where the actors go to see themselves in their new production. It is located near the studio and has a seating capacity of nearly 300. Note the billboards on either side of the lobby. Well, he brought it down. He was flying down to LA one month, and so he came down and he let me scan it, and so we were able to keep it in the family, so to speak. Now, do you know who ran that theater? Do you have any idea who might have run that theater? That little first theater? Two ladies. Pearl Merrill and Laura Peralta, who, when they took down that building, went down the street and bought the property and established the Meralta Theater. And they were both ladies who had performed in vaudeville. Okay, so your third major studio was the Hal Roach Studios, which was often called the Laugh Factory to the world. Hal Roach was the honorary chair of our 75th anniversary celebration for the city, and he came in and to the first event, I believe, and I spent some time on the phone with him. We were putting together the book for the 75th anniversary at that time, and I decided to do a sidebar on him. He was wonderful. He came out to the Chamber of Commerce, and he was gracious, and he was funny, and he had great stories. And so I called him one weekend when I was trying to get everything together to send out, and I said, gee, Mr. Roach, you know, if I have any other questions, could I call you this weekend? Will you be in this weekend? And he went, Julie, I'm old. Where am I going to go? He was almost 100. He lived to be 100. And so, anyway, he was an amazing fellow. And there he is on the studio property with Laurel and Hardy. There's only a small plaque in the area of the expo station in that little parkette that recognizes the existence of that studio, unfortunately. I think we need to do something about that. From 1922 to 1924, Harry Culver was busy building that hotel, which we all still love today. And this is the second floor office of Harry Culver. It can be pointed out to you when you're over at the hotel. And that was a picture of Harry's wife on the credenza. The hotel went through a lot of deterioration at one point, at a lot of points. And as you know, it's looking great now, totally renovated. And throughout the years, because the little people were put up there three in a bed sideways, when they came in 1938 to shoot the Wizard of Oz, they come back every once in a while. They used to come back every once in a while. The only one who is actually still living, I believe, or the last one living, was Jerry Marin, who is this gentleman here. And he was wonderful. He came to our event at the Culver Studios many years ago. Joy Jacobs and I spent a lot of time working on that fundraiser. Remember that?
It was 1989.
Okay, 1989. And we interviewed him. We were able to interview him. And he sang the lollipop song to me. He's very cute. And I know you can't tell who it is, but that is Jerry Marin there. That's his wife.
Elizabeth,
right, uh-huh. And this is one of Hope's friends.
Her alter ego.
We were standing at stage 15 across from 27, which is where the Yellow Brick Road was and where they did a lot of the filming. I felt terrible because here I am so long-legged and I'm dragging these poor people all over the lot. But they were great. They were terrific. They were so much fun. Harry Culver flew out of the Culver City Airport, which was where?
On Jefferson.
Yes, on Jefferson, across from Petrelli's. Where Big Lots is. Yeah, you got to watch this family. They know too much. Harry Culver flew his own plane some of the time, sometimes he didn't. And when he traveled across the country, especially in 1929, that was when he was head of the National Real Estate Association, he took the wife and little girl, and this was a blow up, obviously. They were pretty sophisticated at that time, you know, at the White House, and I think we should be proud. This is about the same time that the last photo. Clearly, we have some of our premier buildings, and we have the Freeman family to thank for keeping this one up. That was the Hull Building, built by Dr. Foster Hull, and it's one of our one of the buildings recognized not only by the city but by us before that. Just so that you know, Stu got a call from Dr. Foster Hull. Stu, where are you? There he is, yeah. You know, he is a really good delegator. So he called me and said one day, so Julie, I got a call from this Foster Hull, and he's Dr. Foster Hull's son, and he's coming in from Hawaii, and I was going to take him to lunch, but I can't because I'm leaving town. Thanks, Stu. What do you want? So he says, would you go over and take him and his wife to lunch? And I said, oh, sure. You know, so I met them over there. In the process of talking, one of the things that had been brought to our attention was that the people over at Akasha, which is the restaurant in there today, thought that there was a ghost. And so this ghost appeared about midnight at the bar. I have nothing to say about that, but anyway. So I said to Foster, the son, I said, so, you know, we have no pictures of your father. Do you have any pictures of your father? Because we have this really interesting thing we're going to try and follow up on. And so he sent me a really bad picture, but it was the only one he had. Nice man. So I believe Stu and I took it over together later. And we took it over to the bartender. We took it over to Alan, one of the owners, and we went over, and he put it in front of the bartender, and she jumped. And that was the image of the person that she kept seeing appearing at midnight. And if you believe that, I don't know, but but it sounds like a good story, right? And it really did kind of make him nervous, so there must have been something to it. Anyway, I think this is my favorite, one of my favorite pictures because of the cap on the guy who's standing there, and you see the old gas station over here, and I've never driven any of those cars, but I sure have great fond memories of being in somebody's seat in the back that opened up when we were kids. So, anyway, if you were looking the other way later on, of course, what you would see is the Washington Building, which is on the National Register of Historic Places and a landmark structure locally also. You'll see the Hull Building right here. You can tell that this is after 1947 because your Culver Theater was there. And in the distance, you have the water tower at then MGM, which is recognized as a historic structure. And you have Leo the Lion welcoming everybody home and the changeable copy that was on top of the Stage 6 complex, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Would you say that was taken from the roof of the hotel?
I'm pretty sure of that. Or at least from a window on the top. Yeah. So let's just go back to the 1928 City Hall. So in 1928, they built the new City Hall, opened it up, or they opened it up then. I love to show this because there's so many people who really have no idea what this is. But you know, don't you?
Clearly.
See, I knew there was going to be somebody so young she wouldn't know. That's a street sweeper. That's how you cleaned the streets in the olden days, as my Auntie Vicente used to say. Okay. So you know now that the new City Hall that was opened in 1995, has a three-quarter facade as you enter, and that is a replica, a three-quarter replica of the front of that structure. Beyond that structure over here was the fire station, and if you went around the corner down the street, you could go into one door and you had your police department offices there, and in another door you had your council chambers. And now you have the police department down the street. Okay, move forward to the 30s and we ended up with Helms Bakery. Paul Helms came from New York, thought he was retiring, clearly did not do that. Established the bakery, which supplied foodstuffs for the 1932 Olympics, which is why it's called was called Helms Olympic Bread. What is the farthest place Helms Olympic Bread went to?
The moon!
Yes! Yes! You get an A tonight, too. Okay, I don't know what you're going to do with it, but... All right, and do you know where the helmsman is today? Sure you do. Marina Del Rey. Yeah, okay. At the park there. All right, now this is a look back in time. So here's your Culver Hotel Hunt. This is what became known as Parcel B, but then it was torn down for obvious reasons later. What hotel was that? No, that was the Adams Hotel. That's where the overflow of the little people went when they brought them in to film The Wizard of Oz. Here you have the Culver Studios, goes all the way back here, Baldwin Hills. Do you know the story about the Machado who lived up in Baldwin Hills and came in one day and was just really upset because he had all kinds of... Well, his wife was upset, actually, because he was dragging in all of this muck that was black. Oil. They're still enjoying the fruits of that. My Machado cousins. Okay, so... For those of you who are old like me, you probably remember Mary Evelyn's Donuts over in this area. And you would remember the bowling alley in the area of downtown there at the pool hall. You had Culver Grammar School here, and now that's the area where the district office is. It's all changed. Braddock Drive used to go through. And the Star News was in there too, yes. Absolutely. Okay. Your Way, later Balian's Market, that is Main Street. So this is the area that is the line of demarcation pretty much. And of course, Venice Boulevard. Just to help you remember. By the 1940s, the moratorium on building was no longer in existence, and so where we had the beginning of industry, other than movie studios, as Western Stove on Hayes Street, misspelled here, they ended up expanding that area, and that became the Hayden Tract. Paul Hayden came from New York and developed this, and I'm sure that you've all either worked there or known somebody who owned a business or whatever there. And so now it has come to the forefront again, redeveloped again, and it seems to be one of the great places in Culver City that makes us look good. If you don't think we've progressed much, I think you need to look at this 1921 picture. Movie studios, Culver Washington X, not much there then. Your Baldwin Hills. The heart of Greenland was planned. This is a 1930s, 40s look at what they were proposing. Do you know what the site of the proposed motion picture expo was? Oops, wait a minute. Did it again. This. Okay, take a look. This was MGM Studios. That was MGM's Lot 1. Overland Avenue, Lot 2. Vets Auditorium hadn't been built yet. That's us right now. Okay. And the actual original plans for that were to build a motion picture expo. It was supposed to have a museum in it. Finally, we've got the archives, at least, to commemorate the city history. But it was supposed to have that. And then why did they build the tower?
To look at the studio.
To be able to look into the back lots and over into the studio, yes, theoretically. And so we grew from 1.2 square miles to just about 5, just under. That's your current annexation map. Again, I need to remind you that we have, in a 5-square-mile city, or just about, we have 7 miles of Washington Boulevard. Once again, because of the possibility of having the businesses that led from Los Angeles through our town to Abbot Kinney's Resort of Venice. And this is Costco today. So a lot of people think that this became this long, strange strip to have Washington Boulevard in there because of the dog racing and stuff. Do you think that's true?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. It wasn't true because the numbers don't work out. It was a different time that they had the dog races. However, I have to say, the one thing that always makes me laugh, makes me smile as I'm going down there, is that in 1984, what did we have in this area?
The Olympic headquarters.
That's right. LA came and they put their Olympic headquarters in Culver City. We also had 2 miles of the marathons, the men's marathon, and also the first women's Olympic marathon that ran through Culver City. So, but it just always makes me laugh. Pat Culver Battle, Harry Culver's daughter, who was always very supportive of the Culver City Historical Society and very helpful, which is why we have the information we have. There she is in one of our parades, riding with one of our favorite supervisors, Kenny Hahn. We have been very lucky to have the support of the Culver descendants. This was during the time that the sculpture, A Moment in Time, was being dedicated, and Dr. John Battle, Harry Culver's elder grandson, was here with his family. There's John, his wife Tammy. She's the one who really wanted to come down for our centennial, and she passed away about a year ago. So the rest of the family is trying to come down. So they'll be down in September. And this is Robert, the only boy of the group. There are 3 girls and a boy, and this is the husband of this young lady. But he's the family historian, and he's the one who's put together all kinds of information for the family as well as us. That was Pat Culver Battle in front of the Historical Society booth, of course, at one of the fiestas. She was terrific, arriving to help and do whatever she could. We would put her on the bus when we took the bus tours years ago, which we hope to be doing again this year. And we would have her on the bus. And of course, she was born the year the city was incorporated, so we would use her as a math problem. She loved it. She thought it was great. All the little kids on the bus would try and figure out how old she was. It was terrific. There she is in my yard with my kid a number of years ago. She was just all over the map. This is Chris Wild, who is the other Culver grandson, who has also been extraordinarily helpful to us. This was recently when he was living in this area. He did a program on the Culver family and the sculpture. He did an incredible job of painless education, which I love. And what he did is he used the moment in time sculpture and said his intent was he wanted everybody to leave that day with something that they could tell somebody if they ran into them when they were in downtown and the people were looking at the sculpture and they didn't understand much about it. So he came up with a lot of ideas so that everybody had a clue about what that was. This is the house that was on Delmas Terrace that is still around, and it's up in Cheviot Hills. This is John Battle, his wife, and the four kids when they were in. And you can see it was moved to Club Drive. So, to make you understand a little bit about the man, other than the fact that his daughter told us that he liked warm plates and cold butter and a bunch of other things, she wrote this just to give us an idea of what she thought of her dad. So I'll let you read. Can you read it, or do we need somebody? Okay, How I Knew My Father, my tribute by Pat C. Battle, Culver Battle. Hardworking, healthy, active, affectionate, reliable, respectable, reasonable, realistic, yearning for progress, youthful. H was for humorous, happy. C was for creative, capable. U, unexpected, unforgettable. L, loving, loyally, patriotic. V, vigorous, vital. E, energetic, encouraging me. R for responsible, responsive to my young thoughts and dreams. And that was written in November 9th of 1983. We have the original. Thank you. I hope you learned something about Harry. If you have any questions, I would try to answer them. Oh, Lord, of course there's a question. And guess who it is? Yes, sir.
How come men's free to ease wear men's free to ease today?